what looks like a pretty standard magician, but look close. What Tom has been doing is experimenting with different slop ratios in the controls, and what he did is he ran the arrow shaft from the bell crank to the elevators and then picked up with a little glued-on horn so that he could vary the amount of slop that's in the control system. Now, I'm not sure, since he's doing glow plug testing today for John Brodak, I'm not sure exactly what kind of testing he's going to be able to accomplish. And the wind is howling too, by the way. Almost unflyable, but we'll see what we can accomplish here. This will be an interesting test either way. So what was the prognosis with the jersey? And you felt the slop was cured 90% of it, 50%, no percent?
I would say 90%, but that's a fair estimate.
Okay, and it was better than the glue-on foam pieces, or not as good? Or
it was not. The glue-on turbulators, I put a turbulator right in front of the hinge line and then alternately a third of the way back on the slab.
Right.
Those did about what the slop did. It cured 90% of the hunting.
Okay.
The other thing that I did with the stab, though, that really worked to beat the band was I put a third of the way back on the stab a piece of eighth-inch balsa.
Okay.
And then stretched just a piece of newspaper over the top of it and taped it down all the way around to give the mean cord line of the stabilizer a crown.
Right,
so it looks like it has some lift. That's a rough parallel to what Bob Whiteley suggested in his
stunts,
that you build it with incidents in the stabilizer.
Okay.
That was the best deal. That didn't almost cure it. That stopped the hunting.
Well, that's a choice. You can do that right at the field. You don't have to commit to anything.
Oh, yeah. That you can try
that.
If
it doesn't work, you can peel the tape off.
You can try that with masking tape and newspaper and throw it away.
The last one flight, don't even put good tape on. Let it be tape that you can take off.
But that airplane has that PPG two-part auto.
Yeah, yeah, you told me, yeah.
I don't want to cut it if I can.
Oh, man.
You know, I'll walk a mile
on
poles before I tear that finish open. Oh, boy.
Another reason to use Brodak dope.
Brodak's dope. tell you what we can do for you, son.
Speaking of dope, there's Ostello pulling in the parking lot.
Oh, jeez. One of these loads, I got to
keep Tommy company. He's got problems back there.
You think these things are marketable, this kind of an earbud?
Yeah, look at Larry's got his new earmuffs. He puts gloves on his ears. Wimp. Why do I hang around with wimps?
He's going to make a movie actor out of all of us.
You're an actor, all right. Now, what is the deal with this?
Well, this is a cowling for a nobler. This nobler's been another one of my long it takes me like 5
Lawrence of Arabia here.
At this point, Lou August and I started in the 80s.
Oh, okay.
We're going to finish it.
For Y2K.
We're going to finish it for Y2K.
Okay.
Anyway, this plane was finished with that technique where we used to put the epoxy and then scrape it off, you know.
Yeah. Okay, that was so real light, boy.
On top of that's auto primer. And after that,
linoleum on top of that.
After that, it occurred to me that it still needed some attention, so I put some Sig Silver over it.
Okay.
So who knows what the heck is going to happen. But it occurred to me that at this point, why don't I just shoot some Brodak dope over
and see what happens.
See what the hell happens.
It's we're not going to learn if you don't have some test pieces.
It's only a cowling, right? If the cowling comes good, I'll shoot the whole plane.
Exactly.
I got to put a screen over here.
Okay. But we want to see how the ballerina is going to come out. The hell with this cowling.
Oh, yeah. Well, we'll do this.
For this 52 Chevy or whatever this thing is.
And the other test, that's one test for the Brodak dope. The other test will be to make a frame, coat it with clear.
Exactly.
And then try polyspan on it.
Okay, and let me know as soon as you know if that's good, bad, mediocre, or not so good.
I want to find that out as quickly as possible.
Yeah,
if
you're going to use that on a ballerina.
I want to use that on the ballerina because I'm not careful.
Yeah.
I'm gonna make
you don't want to make a recall. Testing going on the John Brodak glow plug test. You think all we are is pretty faces. We're out here in 20-degree weather testing things for John Brodak. Come on, John. John, you can at least buy us coffee. Mana, mana.
Windy.
Holy mackerel.
I think we can safely conclude that whatever else we are not pretty faces.
No.
We can guarantee that much.
No, you're right about that.
We know that. Boy, Mike is out here.
I'm impressed. Mike is out here. Usually he's the wimpiest of all the wimps in the club.
I got it last night, Tom.
What'd you do?
The cold shoulder and the hot tongue.
Uh-oh. What'd you do wrong?
I stayed out all day.
He stayed out all day, all night. Didn't tell his wife he was with Wendy in the diner.
Yeah, and she's pissed at you too, by the way.
That's right. He's with Wendy. Ooh.
And Tom, feel good that you weren't there.
Notice Tom's one-flip start technique.
Just shot when I got in from the office.
Tom, put some lighter fluid in. Yeah. At least Larry has a good excuse for not bringing a Blue Angel. Lighter fluid. Anybody has never seen the lighter fluid trick? When a motor won't start on a cold day, 2 drops of lighter fluid.
Should we fill the crankcase up with this stuff?
He's not looking.
Let's blow the roof.
I prefer Ronson. Ronson.
These things slip off your ears.
Now watch this. I don't want to shut the camera so you think there's like a Steven Spielberg thing. This will start on the second flip now.
Nah.
Oh, come on.
I didn't prime it in a stack, so it's going to take a little bit.
It'll bang him on the
bologna. Start right up. Oh, he hit the rubber chicken stick. Like I said, it'll start about the 10th flip.
In one flip. It's a matter of which flip.
Jeez, that smells great. Test Tom forgot to tighten the nuts that are holding the engine.
he had to put that on.
Oh, you did that on purpose. You just wanted to impress John Brodeck.
No, that
John,
was...
John, that would have impressed. You were looking for the engine in the woods.
An engine in the stomach is not impressive.
Yeah. By the way, the cold doesn't affect our value judgments here, does it, at all?
Cold makes me more likely to use a chicken stick.
That's right.
It stinks.
Boy, you cured Louie the whip of that chicken stick thing with the drone, huh?
Now, let's see.
One shot.
Louie was almost out of the hobby in one stroke of the
one bat. Shot did it.
So far is that that my shoes are getting oil soaked from standing up on the table.
Yeah.
The great shoe oiling contest. Story we did to Mike Rogers. You know how he always, if somebody built a pattern mast, he'd run over with a ruler and make sure the tail was 30.1 and the tail moment was 18.2. He was all wrapped up in dimensions. So what we did, we took a set of Big Jim's plans and we photocopied them 1% bigger and then 1% smaller. And every time he'd come to the house, he'd say, your tail is too big. I said, no, measure the plans. He'd go over to the plans. I'd say, no, yours are wrong, Mike. Then he'd go home and he'd chop an inch off his tail. Then we'd get the big plans out.
The other plans would be out
on
the table.
Mike, you cut too much. You better have Scotty make you another tail.
I tell you, what are friends for?
And about, we got away with it for 4 years before we knew we were doing it.
Wait a minute.
Oh, jeez. Being at the field today was even too cold for me. We're going down to Mike Costello's house. Check out the ballerina. It's going to be a future Brodeck dope test play. And we're going to get to see Mike's shop. Now, we've never videoed. This is Mike's new house. We're going to get to videotape his new shop. And this is what I consider real nice about the videos. Most people wouldn't be able to get down to, to see Mike's shop. Very convenient way of doing it. Needless to say, Mike lives in a real nice area here, up on a mountain. Nice area. I've never been up on top of the mountain here. It's real nice, though. Check this house out. I have never been here. This is the first time I'm here, too. Let's see what this shop looks like.
all my subscribers say, well, what kind of house does he live in? Is it a piece of junk?
No, it's really nice.
I think this is a great location. What are you, about 5 miles from the field?
If it's that much.
You could walk to the field from here.
That, to me, that's the most important thing about that.
Wow. This is really... And you got parking for like 12 Audis here. Notice, all these Audis. Kidding, he has an Audi. His wife has an Audi. His son has an Audi. How come I don't have an Audi? Where do you get all these cars? Look at this triple garage. Look what's in the garage. How unusual, another Audi. What's in this side of the garage?
Oh. What's left of the old kit.
How many of these you got? 10?
Well, one's not here. I got 5 of them.
You got 5 Audis? That's cool. Hey, now I would be making my shop right here.
Oh, that's where it is.
Cool. Dump the Audis and get some balsa wood in and some Brodak dope. I don't even think Brodak has 5 Audis.
This is my next new workbench.
Hey, I got a piece of glass for you. I got
a nice piece of glass.
Nice piece. Oh.
You got a bigger one than me.
I got them, and it's got beveled edges. That's totally beveled. It's from a dining room rug. It is. Unbelievable. Now, if people at VSC see this and they buy a lot of Brodak dope, Brodak said he's going to be very happy. If he does, look at this. Nice trophy. I didn't know you were so famous. Wow.
Yeah, nobody else showed up that day.
Yeah. Sometimes I don't even win when nobody shows up.
Well, I'll tell you, if you keep going, sometimes it happens. And that's how you get a few first place trophies.
Yeah.
But see how the fairings came.
See, this is important. There's a thing you didn't do here. You know what's important? Bevel these edges.
I didn't do them.
Put a 45-degree.
I did them on some of them.
Yeah, because if the tissue drops down, it's going to be a problem.
All right, I'll do the rest of them.
Yeah, just hit it with a nail file or something. Okay, and you got your little trim tab guy in here?
Yeah, but I
got
to fix that. It's no good. See the way that wiggles in there? I got to do something different. Because I can't have all that deflection going on.
No, that'll be rattling like crazy.
Yeah, I'm going to do something different there, but the concept is okay.
Yeah, put a ball link on the outside of it, or a little...
Well, that's what you'll see on the other side.
Yeah.
Watch, I'll show you this.
Yeah, but you can't have all that slop, or this
no,
is...
this slop's got to go. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to make a loop and screw it in.
This came out nice, by the way. The last time we saw it, you didn't have the little,
yeah,
the little pieces there. Beautiful.
Those little sanding drops, yep, from the drill press, they, yep, work so beautifully.
Make sure you put a radius on all these edges. And you can put that Brodak Primer on there.
I'm going to do all that.
I should have brought you some Brodak Primer. Oh, that stuff works nice. Yeah, that's really looking good.
What else? The fairings came nice. See, the fairings.
Okay, we should have the double star this week. It's already in transit, so that'll be an easy fix to get the double star in here.
We'll get the double star in. We're going to shift the cowling back 1 inch. You're going to cut the front off the nose.
Yeah.
Shift the nose back to where the stock
to a stock position. Yeah.
Position.
It'll be more. Actually, it'll be more stock then than it is now.
Well, certainly it will be.
Hard not to like a ballerina, Mike. I got to tell you, hard not to like this house. Holy mackerel! Looks good.
It's cold down here, though. It's not the.
Well, you can get a space heater. Thinking, what's so big deal about Mike Costello? Well,
here's the 3 planes.
He's got 19 planes. He's
the ballerina is the one. This,
okay,
the Crusader. This is the other one.
Okay. Right? How many planes you got? Look, he's got racket. The status symbol. How many racks do you have? He's got the beach.
3 racks full.
A yak. I mean, how do you know which plane you even want to fly? When I was in Elvis Presley's, the hell's the name of his town?
Graceland.
He said when he got up in the morning, he didn't know which Cadillac he wanted to drive.
I got that 3 Audis I got to choose from.
Yeah, that's terrible. You should give me one.
What, the red one?
No. Look at this. Yeah, this is a nice setup. These racks, this is Joe Adamusco's rack idea. Give him the credit for that. That worked out well. And you got 3 racks full of planes. All right, way to go. See, I don't like having this many planes because then you never get anything done. I like having 1 or 2 that I'm flying all the time.
Well, they're all in different stages of completion.
You could make some workshop out of this.
Well, there's a lot of little problems in this area because water comes through here when it rains. There's a little river that runs through here. You can see the river.
Get a sun pump.
There's
for $90, you can... Hey, take the werewolf off the wall. I didn't see the werewolf. How many planes you got all together? Do you want me to do a head count? Oh, look, he's got an RC plane, too.
You can't count.
Half-A, stunt. How many? You got 20, 25?
You get to this many, you can't count them all.
So you've spread your talent too thin. Stuntman, he's got a stuntman. He's got a Brodak kit down here. The werewolf is. Now this is cool. He even did the decals. You're a pretty cool guy. I never realized you were this cool of a guy. I think you were just one of these rich, eccentric people I got to deal with all the time. You really are a cool guy. Look at this.
Cool before I...
before he bought all the Audis.
All right, this was the first one I built out of October 59 Flying Models, right? Always was hot for this plane. First time I ever saw it, I thought this was really the coolest thing.
Got a Fox Combat in there?
Yeah.
It is. It's like a Mustang up here. Banjo,
this is Scorinzi's design.
Yeah, I remember. Lowry's wasn't this nice, though. He didn't have a nice finish on it.
Well, I don't know how much care I took, but anyway.
He's not here, we can say that.
That's the one.
Out freezing his ass today.
This is the second one.
That's the second one. The ballerina is the third one.
And the October 59 issue. And then the ballerina is the third one. So.
You are a prolific.
Golden age of flying models. Three killer designs.
Listen to this. So you can hear a toilet flush. Now that's classy.
Leave it to you.
Put some soundproofing on those pipes. See, my wife wouldn't go for that. She'd say, no.
That's too embarrassing for her.
Right. Wow.
So this is the nobler Lou Wallgast than I started.
Yeah, when Lou Wallgast lived here 20 years ago. I would have sent him a copy of this video.
This has a foam wing in it.
Mike, I had no idea you had this much stuff. I'm really impressed.
This is the plane Adamusco gave me. This is the Bobby Hunt.
Yeah, the Bobby Hunt Genesis. Yeah.
Adamusco gave me. Which
is the one that's got no nose construction?
Just the belt was able to get a motor in it. Oh. This you got to see. This is worth looking at.
There's a lot of things down here worth looking at. You have even more stuff than Steve DiGiulio. I thought DiGiulio had the world's record for a nice shop.
Thing is, I get attached to things, and I can't get rid of them. That's why I got all the damn...
That's why my wife has me still. She likes my cookie bacon. Oh, look at this.
So I found a way to shoehorn a Tiger 34 in there.
Oh, okay.
That's a good motor. This is the motor Gieske had in his yellow Nobler at the 92 Nets.
Boy, that's thin. Wow.
Yeah, and see where the mounts are coming right out of the side of the cow.
Yeah. That's not the way I like to build noses.
Now, I took this out to the field and fired it up, and the filter immediately clogged with gook.
Okay.
And I got to put a new tank in. I got to make a tank and put it.
You got to make it because it's so skinny up
you
here.
You can't buy a tank for this.
Too skinny.
So I got to make a tank, and I can give it another shot.
Yeah. No advantage to making it thin like that. Tanks don't fit. Nothing fits.
And if all else fails, Bill Barth is so hot for this plane. I'll be able to trade him something good
Bill,
for it.
Bill Barth would take all your Audis and trade or something.
Something like that. There's an insight. This idea from the Bobby Hunt Billy Weirwich tape. So you cut one rib, and then you slide the wood up.
Right.
And then you put this in place. You're supposed to put a stop here. I didn't bother.
Right.
I just eyeballed it. And then you draw your knife along a couple of times.
Right.
And voila, you got a rib.
Yeah, cool. Tom Morris had a nice little article on making these ribs.
So this was wood left over from my kitchen job.
Yeah.
So I knocked it out of it.
You could always use an Audi dashboard. You know, they're all made out of bread and nylon or something. Good deal.
What else?
But I love the ballerina, man. If this thing doesn't do well at VSC, if you don't rock and roll him at VSC, at least sell some Brodak dope. Now look, he's made the commitment. He's dedicated to Brodak dope.
I'm nuts.
You're nuts. I know that.
I'm nuts for it already.
All right. Well, John, you heard it first.
Based on what I saw you doing with it.
Yeah, well.
The day you had the cowling, you're shooting the cowling.
That's right. You saw that first one.
And then you hit it with the regular air, and it took it right out.
No runs. It's good stuff.
I gotta find the box with all my touch-up guns and my airbrushes. I'm still not unpacked. The year I've been here, I'm not.
Steve DiGiulio has its nice spike he's got on his board. Pictures all on the board and then put the glass on top of it. See, like you have it here?
Take a look at this one. This is Louis Junker's.
That's Louis.
Gobbleschwanz.
The Gobbleschwanz, yeah. How did it fly? Good?
He says it flies good. He says it takes him about 10 flights to get into it. He says the wing offset is what throws him off.
The 2-inch offset, yeah.
Now, I didn't realize it, but his airplane, the Gobbleschwanz, and my airplane, the Ballerina, are fairly closely related because Randall's one of the guys that got
interested.
So this is Gieske's Nobler from the 92 Nets. I'm nuts about that. I'm going to paint mine like that one. Here's the wheel pants I made for it. I gotta figure out how to attach those.
Well, you got a lot of nice pictures here.
And George the Animal Steel, of course.
Oh, of course. I wouldn't have an album without him on the cover. You ever have a scale plane? You were never at the scale, were you?
I'm nuts about the stagger wing, so, like, that's...
Yeah, you gotta buy a real one. Sell all those Audis and buy a real one.
I gotta find a Royal kit.
Here we go. You got a couple extra Nova wings.
That's a Kestrel wing.
That's a Kestrel wing. What's up in the rest?
This one here is...
You should always use wings to insulate your head. You did a lot of building.
Yeah.
God, you got a lot of stuff.
I started a million planes.
Yeah, you know, that's a disease, though. The start planes are not
finished. Two boxes of balsa over there and two boxes of balsa over here.
Wow.
Well, you can see, we didn't even unpack. We're still not
unpacked. Yeah, when I moved into the house, the new house, forget about it.
It takes forever.
Forget it, yeah.
When I get this whole area cleared out, I'm going to have a nice long run, hopefully, of trains.
Mike and I are planning on doing is when he does move his shop out, this is going to be an old gauge railroad.
All along here.
Yeah, boy, as soon as my son moves out of the house, goodbye model planes, man. Old gauge railroading.
He hired me to be the werewolf guy, so when he left for Texas, he didn't want to take this with him, I guess.
Yeah.
He just threw it at me.
So you got two werewolves.
So now I got to fix it. All the parts are taped here, or even with the parts that broke off.
Yeah.
So I'm going to finish it.
Why don't you give it to Larry? He needs a new plane. He's only got 2,000 planes over his
ass. It's a damn good idea.
Why don't we award it to Larry?
Give it to Scorenza. He can finish it.
This would be neat for him to bring it to VSC. He could put it in a glove compartment of his car or something.
Whoever's most likely to finish it is the one that should get it, so it isn't me.
He's only taken 2 years to build a chief wing. I mean, that's not too bad.
Okay, the train's really...
You've seen the whole tour.
I've been collecting over the last 3-4 years.
You definitely have more stuff than I have in Lionel. Oh, you got a lot of stuff. I didn't realize. Rob told me you had a bunch. You got some Rail King stuff?
Yeah, Rail King. I like Rail King a lot. But I go for customized stuff. And I got a couple of people that do custom...
custom
lettering.
Painting?
Here, show me.
You got a lot of Erie stuff? Mike, then now get the picture here. See this layout you have? What I want to do is make... portable sections, so I can just add 4x4 sections anytime I want.
I just set this up. This was Rob's idea. He says, Mike, why don't you take the ping pong table, put some tracks on it, and that way you can have some trains out. And
you got a new Avon E5, yeah.
EP5.
Cool.
But this is a Mike's Train House Doodlebug. And this comes in Santa Fe.
Yeah.
And it's custom painter. He rubs the Santa Fe lettering off of it, and then he put all of the Erie and Lackawanna stuff on it, which I love.
Yeah.
This one's custom made. This was a Missouri Pacific.
Yeah.
And this guy repainted it. And for an extra $60 or so, you got the road name you really want.
Yeah, you want Erie stuff.
Yeah, I want Erie and I want Erie Lackawanna.
Mm.
So you'll see a lot of Erie and Erie Lackawanna stuff on here.
What kind of switches you got? Ross switches?
This is all Ross custom switches.
They work nice?
They work great, but, you know, they're...
You know, what you need is like 10 tables this size, and have them that you can move them around.
Well, I want to do it narrow modules around the walls.
Right.
I want it, so I got a shot at moving it someday if I ever have to.
Well, my idea is when I build it, I only want to have it if I can pick it up and move it. I'm never making another permanent layout. Never.
Get the camera down by the...
sound system in it. Mike's business office. And he's got trains in his business office. Very cool. Old gauge railroad up in his... Definitely cool. See, most people, if you never had to see this, you see Mike at the field and you just assume, he's an average guy. You don't know he's got all these collections of things.
Look at this. That's cool.
Those are old motors that my dad had.
Now look at, he made bookends. Is that ever a nice...
So I made some bookends out of them.
Now that's a cool idea. He's got the Erie Power thing going.
You got that book?
No.
You should get that book.
Erie Power? I think I bought it from you at one time.
Yeah, you did.
Talk about... Now, see, even George Aldrich would like this. Look at this. Bookends with little motors on them. Hey, Brodak, you could make a product. You could make bookends for sale. This would be a nice award instead of trophies. Something like that would be cheaper than trophies, except you supply your own motor. Definitely. Mike, there's a lot of stuff here. It's a cool place.
Thank you.
Perfectly normal, his Elvira calendar. This guy. Mike loves, we're right on the Erie Lackawanna tracks here, too. He's
got I got the
CB Snow
HO version and the O version of these two cars, and there's the S gauge version of this.
Yeah.
And now I'm going to try to find N scale versions of them, some of my favorite cars.
Go down to train show. I was down there last week. Beautiful. Love that O gauge layout. Yeah, it's open today. This is Mike's kitchen. This is like a bay window caboose. Look at this. Wild. Corian, we're making molds out of Corian now down at the shop.
Yeah, we can't have any of this Corian. I do have some scraps though.
You got, don't throw scraps Corian away.
Never throw scraps
away. Makes nice molds. You can probably make bell cranks out of it too. This is some kitchen. You guys did this? It's got the TV so we can watch
Howard Stern.
Howard Stern in the morning. You gotta show Karen. See, you guys did the island and I did the stove.
This island was designed completely differently.
Look at the macaroni thing. That is cool as hell.
It's decorative. It's more so functional.
My whole life is decorative, not functional. And you got the dining room going in there?
Yeah, everything's cluttered on account of we're getting ready for Christmas.
This is nice. I like the bay window in the kitchen right by the sink.
Yeah, that's pretty. You look at the front.
Oh, yeah.
And once in a while we get deer walking around in the church parking lot.
Yeah. This poor woman is subjected to watching windy videos in bed.
No, listen,
in bed.
Listen.
Mike's wife is sick of watching windy videos.
Oh, I don't watch. I just hear your voice.
Oh, and it makes you crazy, doesn't it?
No, it's a nice somber, nice quiet. No,
you know that
you mixed up with.
No,
Irwin.
No.
Billy Warwick is more boring than I am.
No, I know him too, but you play plenty of Windy.
Oh, that's unsolicited testimonial.
No, it's true.
I wish he'd die, then I wouldn't have to watch
him. Wait a minute. Why do I have to listen to this
vehicle? Who puts you to sleep faster, Windy or Billy?
No, Billy.
Billy puts you to sleep?
Definitely.
Call Bobby Hunt and get a refund.
Billy has a calming effect.
Oh, wow. Unsolicited testimonial.
Let me tell you, I have a very clean shop. I never saw it in person, but it's very nice on the view.
It's a big Ben.
This shop is clean enough.
It's a big Ben, Billy.
No, it looks very clean.
Well, we couldn't have finished the ballerina without Billy's tape. Thank you, Billy.
Oh, we laugh at Billy, but he's a good man.
But when he listens...
Unsolicited testimonial. Bones here. He just got another pipe. Now this is, tell me again, this is Randy's pipe.
This is Randy's pipe. That he gave me sold me with the 60.
Okay. This is my old pipe from 1987, 1991.
And
this is George's pipe. Now when we compare, and I'm very curious, we compare the volume in George's pipe and my old pipe, which is soon to be my new pipe, almost identical. I don't think it's off by a millionth of an inch. Randy's pipe, this is a 60 pipe. He said this is a 60 pipe, right? Oh, you got a 60 engine.
Correct.
And a pipe, okay.
And that's the pipe he sent me.
Okay, so we're going to find out now what we're going to try to do next time we get out to Fleischstraeger is we're going to be able to put this pipe on, take George's pipe off, put this pipe on, and see if anything changes. So now we got a good comparison, but I can tell you right now the volume is a lot bigger in both of those. This is almost like, well, it's bigger than the one Rich has. Again, you're not going to know until you fly it. You got to put it on a plane and fly it, and I mean, you're not going to wear it out, that's for sure. The workmanship is real nice. Now look at the back here. We'll find out if oil stays in that back piece, or you need to put a rubber thing on that, or what. It's a long time coming. That's what I was going to do to my pipes, bend them like that.
Anyway, it'll be very interesting test to see if we get to fly Sunday. Be very interesting.
If it doesn't snow.
Yeah.
What an ice storm.
All right. This is the phone call that you made?
I don't know what I'm doing, Wendy. That's why I need your...
You're the perfect customer. He doesn't know what he's doing. Has no money. All right, that looks like it went pretty good. You did this right off the videos, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so what's wrong with this?
Well, my question is this. How much do I cut off the center? Because you told me that the tail itself has to be cut down. The stabilizer and elevator. Is this the right dimension? Is this what I
should tell you right away. It won't take a minute to figure this out.
Just go slow with that saw. Just go very slow. You got it. All Rich is doing is taking the shrunk out. This is all on the video. What is that, the Strega video you took this off? On the Strega video, the tail copy. Sucker's got my master copy if I get eaten in his machine. Anyway, the machines are joined before you actually make it. This is the best way to make a foam tail, by the way. Work right off the Strega video. Don't fool around. Tails always come out light and straight. Don't trick with this saw. Just go slow. The whole trick. Right on the line. Boy, you're an artist, I'll tell you.
What kind of an artist?
We can't say on tape. You have the first piece, just take that out.
And you just need to glue the trailing edge on the stab, the leading edge on the elevators. And you're in Fat City. Oh, what's nice too is we have that glass table. And that's that little glass piece of glass to get that edge perfectly straight. And that's ready to put the leading and trailing edges on. Hey, I see Rich is being real smart about this. Every time he gets to a certain point, he brings it over here and we try to upgrade it or correct any little errors that he might have. So, anyway, how's he doing? Is it all finished in there, Jack?
Yes, sir.
All right. Keep him working. I like him better when he's working.
Come out all right, Rich?
Okay, good.
Okay, the guide is all right. Just make sure it's a nice straight edge when you're done. You got 3/8 in hand, half in, a quarter inch wood, I mean, home?
Yes.
Okay. You know, you want to use a nice soft piece for that because you got to carve in
you
that lead.
You have it?
Yeah, of course.
Oh, fine.
No, I mean, I didn't know if you had it. If you have it, you know, you've got to get a bite.
It's not as good as yours.
You're so honest. Now, see, if we were having a nice pizza pie now, Rich, I'd be in a mood to give you a couple of pieces of wood, but now you're going to get charged list price, six prices for the wood. Oh, man.
Keep going, baby.
Now, this weekend's project, rather than work on the airplane or do something that would be model related, we're going to wallpaper this room. And I just can't wait to go get the tools, the ladders. Anyway, we have put so much time into this house. Hey, and I know some of the people like Mrs. DeJulia, they just love watching me slave away when I could be downstairs working on my Rosemary. I could be downstairs working on my Spitfire. Instead, I'm up here. And this next time you see this room, it'll be wallpapered. Wallpapering, one of my favorite jobs. Hey, there's that furniture counter we finished. Now, if you think they eliminated slave labor at the end of the Civil War, you haven't been around Karen long. This is a choice of color. What's funny is doing the molding from white to beige, taking longer than the rest. And doing a ceiling, that's the worst job of all. Oh. The ceiling's almost dry. Buy an old house for fun and profit.
careful.
Check, yeah, don't scare her. Anyway, beginning of day two.
Oh, there is also a beautiful finch. Is that finch?
Yeah, there's a redhead finch out there.
Finch out there.
Day two of the great wallpaper job. Everything should be dry. Ready to start hanging wallpaper. Hanging birds. First wall up. Boy, what a pain. This is some fancy wallpaper. Hard to get all the bubbles out and everything. Reflective. Yeah. I only got about half done. Third done. Anyway, you can see the cast. This wallpaper turns from gold to silver as you walk past it. It has a nice Victorian cast to it. But painting the moldings took all day yesterday. That job behind us, we're ready. This is a big job. Anybody needs help wallpapering, you know what? Hire a guy. 3 days, we worked a long time. We're really proud of the job we did. Back to the shop. Some of the detailing on this furniture. Anyway, this was some big job. Bigger than we really thought it would be, but hey, everything worth having is a big job. Back in the shop. Hey, and I want to thank Bill Hummel for the gracious donation of gloves. They really worked well. Anyway, I got the first piece off. This was just a test piece to test the mandrel. And so far, hey, the finish looks pretty good on it. It came off reasonably, so we'll be working with that more. Jimmy's making up the big mandrel, I don't know, sometime this week. We got gear laid up everywhere you can look. There's gear moles. And one of the things I want to do is get a rough fit on the two shells that are going on the top of this. Maybe even get them installed today. I don't know. We're expecting more snow. We just never get the weather straightened out here. It came in the mail today. A nice present from Bill Zimmer. Nice for the train going to the train shows. Hey, Bill, nice for wearing. Anytime. And by the way, we are going to be, hopefully, in the next month or two, Craig's going to be moving out of his room. We're going to be starting to lay out our big, giant O-gauge railroad. More on that. Hey, I want to get these blocks and get a rough fit on them. Or at least, no, we don't have the canopy yet, so we really can't do much, but at least I can get them fit. Maybe we can get them tack glued in place. What I wanted to do is just get a rough fit. Since we don't have the canopy, I want to... Any of these kind of jobs, I always like to start in the front and work my way back, but make sure I need to put the reinforcing in there, of course, yet. Now, anybody that doesn't know or hasn't done an X-member reinforcement, several good ways I've done over the years, yeah, everything looks like it's going to fit just fine here. But again, you never really know. The blocks, these, just to show what happens is over time, these spring back, but it's no problem. We're going to run the glue seam anyway. So one of the things I want to do here, at this point in time, everything is relatively flimsy back here. So I want to lay out some X members, and I'll get some maybe eighth by quarter, some nice sea grain wood if I can find it. Lay this out. That's just a reinforcing thing, but every step of the way on doing that, what I want to make sure is that I don't put a twist in the body. I want to make sure I maintain that where the wing is right, perfectly level. So let me lay this out, get a rough idea.
strip down some of the wood. Maybe I get that done tonight too. Been so busy with these carbon parts, it's hard to get a solid, dedicated block of time to work on this. Thing I want to do is I want to get down in here with a Q-tip and some thin CA to harden up and fuel-proof that wood, just in case. This is inside the pipe tunnel, so in case any of the oil does get through there, I don't want to turn in the back of the body into a sponge. And you can see how much of a room I've left. There's plenty of room for the arrow shaft. I want to lay this out right into the carbon. It gets laid right into the carbon. It doesn't go onto the wood. Always onto the carbon makes it even more rigid than it normally would be. And this, by the way, this will work on any stun ship. This little technique that I use, used it 100 times already. It works on every ship. It adds so little weight that doesn't even pay to weigh before and after. But it really, really, if you were to take this now and twist the fuselage, you'd say, I don't know. You put the top lock on, yeah, it does get a little stiffer. But it doesn't get anywhere near as stiff as if you put X-members in here. X-members. We've done that enough times to know it's a tremendous stiffening of the fuselage. At almost no, there's no penalty. There's certainly very little, if any, weight penalty. Got a real nice piece of, let me find a real seed grain. This is a nice piece of open scrap. I'm going to strip up four or five pieces, roughly a quarter inch. Again, you don't really need rock hard wood here. In fact, if you have a piece of real soft punk wood, this is a good place to use it up. Do this is just flex the fuselage and see about where the first part of the bend would be. Now, in my case, it's right up here. And I'm going to try to lay out the first one right. Well, maybe I can go even further. Looks like I can go a little further here. Some of this is really hit or miss. But by getting these in, each time you, what'll happen if you start at the back and work to the front? Each time you add one of these little X members, what happens, the bend, like this is flexing right here. So when I put this reinforcement in, I flex it, that bend is gonna keep moving up, and at some point in time, it'll stop. And then you've got as much rigidity in here as you need. Once I've got the first one in, but now I can see already I've moved the point where it's bending. In fact, it's still bending back here. I need to connect the dots here a little bit. Always pretty careful about getting nice corners and edges as I fit these pieces in. And this is one of the things, it just takes a little bit of time to get all these angles and corners and edges. But when you're done, it really pays off. You really don't want to fill the seams with glue. I want to make as tight of a fit here as I possibly can. See, we've gone back and forth. Now we've moved the point at which it's bending further up. Now I want to connect these two points.
Piece, and you can see we almost can't move the fuselage at all. That's about as rigid as it needs to be, but I'm still going to connect these four pieces. This piece is keeping us stiff and rigid up in front, so I think the only two pieces we'll need are another X member here, another one here. And that'll, because of the pipe tunnel makes that part of the fuselage real rigid. We really need to only go from the pipe tunnel back. This really got really nice and stiff in a hurry with those, just a few little pieces. See, after two of these, we've got the movement
just ever so slightly forward of that.
Now I decided I'm going to move that point even further up after thinking about it for a while. I don't want it to end right where that reinforcement ends. It's going to make me a stress riser. I'm just going to add the third one in there and then complete the X's. And that should do it because that carbon's running the whole length of the fuselage top. That should really make it really rigid when it's finished. Believe it or not, I'm thinking you don't even need these X pieces. This wound up being so rigid. Wow, I just can't believe it's that rigid. I'm trying to decide. I can't decide if I want to put those X pieces in or not. What would I gain? It really did make it very rigid. That's unbelievable. It always impresses me when I do that. Weakest link in this chain, at least right now, is right here in the back. So I'm going to put that X piece in the back. I'll probably put the X's in the whole thing. I keep teeter-tottering with the idea of leaving these two out. Well, hey, it's so rigid now. I just can't imagine that's going to make a big deal, but since I've always put them in the past, and I've always noticed after the block is on, one of the things you gain is when the dope starts shrinking on the body, you don't get those ripply, you kind of have a spar going right down the whole fuselage, which is nice. So I guess I'll just finish the rest of these little pieces. Again, the amount of weight that they're probably 2 grams or something, but boy, anytime you ever do this test and just see how rigid that gets, wow. It's more rigid with that on there than it is if I just put the block without it. It's hard to believe, but and a lot of times it's just easier to just fit one end of this. Not the only way to do it, that's for sure, but if you fit one end, let me just see if I can get this one on here. This is where you always glue your hand to the part.
Alright, try to get your hand on it there. Forget it.
Here it goes. Now, with that piece in there, now that's kind of tack glued in. Now I can get this alignment and get a real nice fit here in one stroke of the pen. Otherwise, it can take you all day to make these little pieces up. It's all a free flyer's trick. Now, what's funny about my career, I made a lot of free flight planes. They always started out to be RC planes. And somewhere in their life, they became free flight planes. Back in the days of Bonner escapements and who knows what, people didn't even know smoking causes cancer back then. So what could we have known about RC? Think about it. Going over this over and over again, and even in my own mind, I try to take the fuselage, I'm trying to look down it and see where it's twisting when I put pressure on it, because that's what would happen in the real world of aerodynamics. I'm going to even add one more to this. See what I'm trying to do is get away with as little as possible, but every time I add one of these, I realize, look at this, UPS is here. I realized just how important this was and how many planes I retrofitted this to. Totally changes the way a plane flies when the fuselage is nice and stiff in the back. Now this is a great time to tell a real quick story. And this is a true, all my stories are true. I don't have to make this stuff up. There's enough crazy stuff happening all around me. Jim Casal, and obviously one of the top flyers of ever, period. He had a plane and I don't remember which one it was, but he had me fly it, and I flew it, and this plane was just, it was scary how rubbery it is. It just, no matter where you put it, it was like on rubber rails. It was terrible, like a train on macaroni. But absolutely true story. He went home,
and I believe, I never saw him do it, but I know he did it. Other people have told me. Cut the top off the plane, and Lou Dudka and Glenn Metter gave him this idea of how to do this, and of course I looked at it and I said, hey, pretty good, I'll try it too. And that plane, when he had it all put back together, that plane was like he had a whole new airplane. And I remember other things that were wrong with the plane, the tail was flexing and everything, but it was that body. He had won the Nats in, let's see, in 83. 83 won the Nats, and so he made this plane that he called the Clone. And we all called it the Clown, because it really wasn't a clone. A clone is when you duplicate the plane exactly as it was. And what he did, he duplicated the plane and made every part a little bit skinnier than the original plane. Well, it was a rubber plane. That's all I remember. I remember flying it at Flushing and being scared I'd crash it. It was downright scary how rubbery it was. But one of the things that cured it, and Glenn and Lou Dudka, Glenn Metter and Lou Dudka really had a slick idea here. This worked out so well. I know it's been published. It's not like a new thing or anything. But believe me, if you've never done this to a plane and seen the difference in rigidity for a couple of grams of weight, you'll be totally impressed. And of course, then you can buy me the mandatory pizza. Anyway, I'm going to add that extra one. And I just keep thinking about that. I had my lunch with Karen. And I was thinking about telling her funny stories about Jimmy Casal. And that certainly was one of them. That light blue plane that he called the Clone. Wow. That was one of the scariest planes I've ever flown. There's a feeling when you have a plane that's bending in the wind, whether it's the controls or it's just the airframe itself that's flexing, that's just downright. The only thing you can relate it to is a railroad engineer coming down the track on macaroni instead of steel rails. Just unbelievable. But anyway, a true story, a good story too. And by the way, that's one of the reasons I always have as many people as would be interested in flying some of my planes. I certainly welcome the opportunity to get feedback from them and get ideas from them. And also, and I know this happened to Mike Palko and Dan Banjock this year, they got to fly Straeger and got a little feel for just how I set a plane up. And it's possibly something they can put into their own little repertoire, little arsenal, itinerary. Is it itinerary or arsenal? I don't know what I'm talking about. I've been watching too many Essence of Emeralds lately. Anyway, if you get no other tip off of this tape, two good tips. Don't ever volunteer to wallpaper a room and put your ex-members in.
More to go and we'll be done here.
I checked this with all the ex-members in, they're all tacked in from dead front to make sure I haven't put a twist in here. And now I'm going to start at the back and just go down each glue joint. And after this I'll check that I haven't put any torque or any twist in here. Again, it seems like this is all overkill, but when you're all done with a plane and it's got a bend in it, you say, how did that get in there? And boy, we've all done that. Anyway, you think of the incredible time you put into a plane like this, into any plane. You only have so many of these in your life. You just don't have, like, we're all going to run out of life pretty soon. Anyway, I heard from somebody, I forgot to write his name down, a guy that had built, he's coming out the Brodax contest, he was an Air Force person, he's coming out the Brodax with an exact replica. Bill Hummel, listen up, an exact replica except for the retracts of Harold Price's Crusader. Now, anybody that's never seen that plane published and knows how difficult that wing is to build, that wing is a little bit labor intensive too. But you know, if you don't want the labor, then don't build planes at all. You get into something a lot easier. Every night lately, my wife's been making me watch Essence of Emerald. She's into this, watching the cooking channel. I don't know. And I don't cook at all, but I love Emerald. He's got such a nice personality.
He talks funny like I do, so how you cannot like him. Anyway, we'll check that that's nice and straight.
Now, after all this, this is the key thing I want to see. I want to see that tail drop. Just looking at some of the little things that are different about this plane and when you do a typical D-tube plane. The next thing I want to do is I want to tack the nose block on. It's like an airplane already. Boy, this is the part where it really gets to be fun. The parts will start to come together.
Anyway, this is the original shell that we made. I want to make sure I get a nice tight fit on this. Now, what I always like to do with the shells is I like to epoxy the first maybe 6-8 inches up to where it goes into the wing, up to where the wing connects. I like to have this joint here done with epoxy, then I CA the rest. So what I want to do, I want to mix up some slow drying epoxy and get this taped into position. And this can be drying while I'm taking a little break. Main things I want to get is a good bond up here so I don't get a crack in that paint. And the idea of using the slow drying epoxy, this is 45 minute epoxy, what happens is I'll have some time to tape it down and get it even, and it's paper thin in a couple of spots here. But I do want a good joint. And I'm going to glass the whole nose, so that's really not a factor in this. But I do want that nice clean joint as far back as I can get it. Let's see, that's back a little bit too far. Say from there out. And what I'll do is I do a press down, make sure I have plenty of little contact area. And since the shells tend to spring a little bit in time, I want to get this taped down during the dry cycle. Okay, now I can see any spots that I'm missing. Have the alcohol ready to wipe the joint. I really want to get from the front of the wing forward, really. I guess this is one of those vulnerable areas that if you don't have a good joint, what happens, what tends to happen, is you get a crack in the paint. The crack in the paint lets in some oil, and the whole front of the plane starts to wick oil. And several people, the worst one was Mike Rogers, actually lost a whole plane from one crack in the paint. Somewhere in the nose, right in front of the landing gear, oil was getting in, the whole belly filled up with oil. It was just unbelievable. Okay, now what I can do is get rid of some of this extra glue. I need to make that little former inside while this is drying. Now, a lot of people like to just go and slap this on with thin CA. No problem. I just think this is a little bit of an improvement over that system. And no matter what, this is one of those things, no matter what plane you build, that nose section, that's a critical part of it. And the only reason I'm rushing is I want to have as much time as possible to clean this up. All of the epoxy that oozes out during a dry cycle. This just saves some sanding. That should make for a nice joint. this little spot up here, I'm not really concerned with. That's going to fill with epoxy eventually. CA epoxy something.
Okay, the only thing left to do here is just run that glue seam. I always like to hit this with a hairdryer too before I pull the tape off, so that if there's any stickiness left inside or some part of the epoxy didn't totally cure, it gets glass hard.
Just makes for a little bit nicer joint.
Okay, what I did, I tack glued this from the outside, and now with the just using gravity, I can kind of line this up and soak the joint from the inside. And just watch it run right down and whoops, there we go. Right down the nose. When I see that coming out by the motor mounts in the front, I know I've run the whole joint. Let gravity work for you. There it goes. You'll glue the plane to the carpet about six times before you figure out how to do this. Yeah, you've never seen Essence of Emerald, boy. Check it out. Even if you don't like to cook, and I'm not, believe me, no interest in cooking at all. 1-800-PIZZA is my thing. Okay, it's dripping out the nose, so it's probably a real good joint. I just want to do a little cleanup of this joint. Again, the best way to do this is by your bare hand. You're always going to pick up the high spot the easiest with your bare hand. And a good old Bob Martin sanding block, needless to say. Get that joint to go away is to thin CA the wood around it. And the object of this is just to harden it up so we get a smooth transitional joint. Especially up around the nose ring here. A couple of coats of thin CA always seem to work real well on this. Again, we are going to glass the whole nose, so we want to have all the contours sanded. The contours have to be perfect before you glass, otherwise you cut through the glass at the corner. Again, now that the wood is hard around the hardwood joint, now I can do a relatively nice shaping of it. Notice how I always add that word relative. This is so much more fun than wallpapering. Hey, I know people enjoy watching me suffer. Boy, that war, I was on that ladder for 3 days. Bad enough when you have to work like that and get paid for it. When you work like that and you don't get paid for it, it's really going to add insult to injury. Oh, yes. The whole key. When I sand through, get a little more thin CA on there. Just keep back and forth, and it eventually you'll get that blend where the whole thing blends in real nice.
Yeah, it sanded out relatively nice. But again, I've just gone back over these over and over with thin CA and then sand it out. It's that hardening up of all the wood around the joint that allows that joint to disappear. Take to get a look at what it's going to look like with the spinner on there. And now that we have carbon fiber back plates, that'll allow us to make some, well, some changes to the overall weight of the spinner too. These are beautifully made, by the way, from Randy Smith. I have a few of them too, but he's the one that's producing real nice. I'd like to get a look at it from all the angles. Again, we're going to have a lot of detailing up here. Exhaust pipes, valve cover reliefs, and maybe even that shark mouth. I don't know yet. Anyway, that's all we're going to do today. We're going to pack it in. See you tomorrow. On today's mail. Killer day. Killer day here. Check this out. We just got 100 sets of... These are the straightest, best motor mounts John Gajewski has ever cut. They are real. Look at the grain in these. Perfect sandwich grain. You know how hard it is to get wood with sandwich grain? Anyway, I've got about 100 sets for any lucky subscribers that need a set right away for a building project. Boy, stock up on them now. These are extremely hard to find, nice and straight like this. Hey, some pictures from Bill Hummel. These are the new ship he's building, one of three new ships. Steve Busso designed Knockout 60. Glenn Keller, Len Harding, and I are building. I'm reading this right from the note. All for Super Tiger 60 power, easy to build, no tricks, just solid, good looking, hopefully good flying airplane. Hey, it will be. Trust me, this looks great. He's using Big Jim proven technology, all pro stunt bulletproof hardware. Plans to do a Brodak dope finish. I don't know how you can lose with that combination, Bill. Anyway, one of the things I want to say. Not many people put back into the hobby as much as Bill has. And he's helped and also run the contest in Coxsackie many, many times. And I'm just going to run these pictures by. A nice set of pictures. I'll pass them on to Stunt News. Bill, I'm really glad that you're having such good luck. And believe me, you are going to have luck with that Brodak dope like you've never had before. I really am. Look, he's got the ellipse, the glass ellipse in the middle. This looks like it needs a nice set of carbon fiber gear from the new mold, Bill. Not the one. Bill has the original prototype. The new mold is even nicer. Play your cards right, Bill. I'll swap you for about 2,000 sets of rubber gloves. Hey, no kidding around. This looks like a nice plane. Big tail area. Looks like a 25% tail area. Anyway, check it out. I really have to say, Bill, you are one of my wife's favorite people. And that's hard to do. See, my wife, I don't know if I have her spoiled or she has me spoiled or what, but she always says, oh, gee, that Bill Hummel is such a nice guy. Maybe she just doesn't know you good enough. Anyway, beautiful plane. Hey, I got to tell you, let's get back to the main picture here. And Bill, there's another part of this that... Little known facts in stunt history. He is one of the nicest guys. I just don't know where he gets this hair. When you see his baby, the baby has such beautiful hair. Bill, we love you, guy. And hey, think about a nice carbon gear for that guy. And don't tell Kaler, to heck with him. There's another, believe it or not, Jim Hoffman. Now Jim just got his carbon fiber gear. I see they're not even on a plane yet. Anyway, from Arizona, pictures of his two new ships, and we'll be passing these on. This looks like a Magnum, obviously. This looks like an Impact. And Jim, I have to tell you, if you're not happy with the carbon fiber gear, I'll make one even lighter. I know there's a guy, I can't think of his name, a guy in Missouri that just ordered carbon fiber gear. He wants to have that clip go over the pipe. Well, wait a minute, if this one fits on an Impact, the one I sent him has to fit. I don't understand. But anyway, more on that later. We're going to be having some more tricked out stuff. See, he's got some other thoughts on this anyway, but Really nice impact. Jim, thanks a lot. I appreciate it a whole lot. Now I got something that's really so special, it's unbelievable. This is from Roy Cherry in England. I'm reading a very long, detailed note about where these pictures come from that he just sent. This is his control line stunt plane, of course, but this is one, we've been looking for pictures of this plane, I kid you not, years. This is the G-Flyer. It's an all-red Spitfire, late model, with the rotor that Joe Adamusco's modeled. Kind of a unique, this is the first time I've noticed the trim on the ring as being matching. It's got a spinner with painted jet. We have some very few pictures of this plane. This is always one I've wanted to model, and certainly in the future I can't do this one because this is an early model. This is a late model Spit, double canopy version. Now Roy is going to be looking out in England for more pictures of the G-Flyer for me. He took these pictures, and he says he took them in 1982, and he thinks, but he's not sure, that the plane is now in the United States. Well, he's going to do some research. I really have to tell you, now that all my videos are in England, and by the way, thanks a million for the pictures. I just can't tell you. Joe and I both appreciate these pictures so much. And now we have our full line of videos available in England.
We'll take a minute to thank everybody that sent photos in. I love having these photos in the shop.
Into today's layup, as I've been doing every day, I've been using up the extra resin, just seeing what these back plates would look like or how they'd come out or whatever. We definitely have the weight down to where it's half of the aluminum, and there's no way you're going to break these. My only concern is this going to be a part that's, that people are going to need, because obviously the problem is if you have a plane that needs nose weight, not a whole lot of point of putting that in. But anyway, if you're trying to get nose weight out, and some of the planes I've seen that really you could use all the weight out of the nose that you want, that would be an appropriate part. Now I have 2-inch ones, 2 1/4, I'm sorry. I'm going to be starting up on a mold to make 2-inch ones soon. These fit the Aero Product spinners. And obviously if anybody wants one, you know, give me a holler. These are still in the prototype stage, but every day I get to make one. I make up the 3-gear and a back plate, so the trick I've found to getting these to come out with very little and almost no machining is to get this Teflon paper, which I got from Dave Midgley. This is his little guy. Get a block with a flat, smooth edge, and it just, when I put weight on here, what happens is it, you'll see it'll squeeze out all the resin and gives me a good starting point. Just that much less, because I'm going to have to machine that surface and make up a little mandrel, but this at least gets me started that I don't have to start from machining up a big rough edge. Uh-oh, President Backplate Nixon on the phone. One of the little experiments I wanted to do is before I lay up another part, and I'll show you what happened with this. Well, this is just the test part anyway. What I wanted to do is put a layer of, this is 1/2 ounce cloth, underneath the sock, because that sock just, there's pinholes all over it when you do nothing but a sock. There's just almost no way you can get away from it, other than the thing that people are doing now is just painting on a whole other coat of resin, and that adds a lot of weight and almost no strength at all. So I'm not crazy about doing it that way, but of course I'll try everything first. What I'm trying to do is lay on, let me get the rest of this group off, lay on, this is a coat of 1/2 ounce, and then put the sock right on top of this. So I'll have a 1/2 ounce and hope and see what that looks like in terms of sealing up the pinholes. Now if this 1/2 ounce cloth is going to help to seal the pinholes, but again, if it doesn't, we're going to try other things. This is just one of many experiments. Pinholes are loaded, the back plates are loaded, everything's ready. We're ready to go work on the Spitfire for a little while. At last! Free at last!
Back plates have worked out real well. I'm just wondering if there's going to be a any market for it. If there's a market for the True Turn ones, they're kind of thick too. Another thing I let you do is you have clipped the edge on these. I want to be able to fine tune them for the spinner fit, so I can make them just a little bit thicker, a little bit thinner. That's a nice advantage. And hey, again, we're just using up scrap resin and material. Even have the original plug to make them the mold if we want to make two a day. I guess we could do that with spare rubber too. That's one of the things you could pick up off the video, is just how some of these things get done and how you can do them economically and how you can do them in a, I don't know, in a way that I guess makes sense to everybody.
Now, I sanded this in yesterday. I had to put two little spots of DAP up here. I just want to dress them off. I want to flip it over and get that little foam I'll put in them underneath that'll hopefully now. This is a really good trick. I always do this. I'm done with the molding. I clean my hands. And what I try to do is start at the top of the fuselage and feel for any spots that feel like a joint or like something is not right. Because I want to be done with this. This is almost ready for fiberglassing. And we're going to be putting a lot more detailing on the nose, but I want the glass to go right around that in one piece.
One of the things, every time from this point in the construction on, every time I take the cowling off, here's what happens.
I'm sure this is something that's really important.
Every time you sand this area, you build a real sharp edge along here. So what I like to do is very methodically, every time I take the cowling off, break that edge. Just break it. Even with a couple of strokes of sandpaper, because what that's going to ultimately do is leave a radius there for the paint. If you leave a sharp edge, it'll start peeling up like sandpaper, and you'll have a real good chance of buffing through. So every time you take a surface apart where it's been sanded flat like this, well, it's real easy. Just break that edge. Now, we put a lot of hours into getting this cowl shape just the way we wanted it. One of these, just breaking the edges a minute or two each time you do a sand out, gives you that where the paint will wrap around and you won't get that edge where as soon as you buff it, there'll be a spot, a buff through. Making this little piece, because obviously I want to seal this. Now I've been making it oversized. I think it's just still a bit oversized, and I can pull it out. And I want to kind of compress it in place and then seal it in all dimensions. Now, you can see how many times, look at this piece. How many times has this been in and out of the plane? 50 times, but the trick is make it a little bit oversized. Just see where it's hitting, just like doing sheetrock work. And then when you're all done, make up a good part with fewer pinholes in it. Now, obviously, one of the things I want to do is make sure this is sealed before I really permanently glue it. And I've just been pushing it very slightly. I don't want too much tension on it. I want this to come out the top like a starving horse.
And now when it's in position, this is a real good trick too. From time to time, you want gravity to do the work. And I want the glue to run right down that edge. Now it'll serve two purposes if I can do this, if I can get it into the corners. Now years ago, what I used to do, and it was really foolish when you think of it, I used to take epoxy and basically mix up 3 ounces of epoxy and paint the whole inside of the tank compartment, and it served no purpose at all. Just added weight for nothing. Bordak Dope is as fuel-proof as anything you can use. So we're just, when we get to the point of fuel-proofing, we're just gonna fuel-proof it with Bordak Dope. Oh yeah, that's nice. Let the gravity do the work.
I wanna make sure everything in this area, because this is gonna go right up into these corners, I want to take some thin CA, soak it with a Q-tip, and just paint that whole inside of that shell. It'll harden up the wood, and it'll totally fuel-proof it in one stroke of the pen.
That pipe tunnel should really work well. Famous last words. I really hope it is going to work well.
Now, I've let gravity do most of the work here, but I want to make sure this is all sealed. This also hardens up the wood, too. And as opposed to epoxy, which, I don't know, years ago, it was funny. I'd just mix up a batch of it, and I think it was all unnecessary. Now I can tip the plane on its side both ways to get in the corners, but I want to know because, well, we can't really get in here and wipe this off once the engine's in a plane conveniently without taking the engine out. And keeping the nose of the plane from getting a lot of little cracks on it is real. To me, it's an important thing anyway, even this little piece back here. Well, I just hate when you get all those little cracks and oil gets in the paint and that whole year's work goes up in smoke. Starts turning the plane into a sponge. The reason some of my planes have lasted as long as they have, and it seems to me like they've lasted an incredibly long time, one of the reasons is that I try to keep after having these little oil holes that allow oil to get in there. I may as well even paint this. It's cheap insurance. A lot of times it's weeks or months between times you can wipe this off. So having it nice and fuel-proof now is really an advantage.
I want to do to get the turtle deck tacked on. We did a little preliminary fit when we made it. Real, looks like it's right on the money for a change. It's probably not off by much. What happens though is all these shells, they tend to spring in time. So what we're gonna do is just tack each side just a little bit. You gotta cut the back out here. In fact, let me wiggle this around. This is the part that's a little bit of a nuisance, is getting this piece notched out for the tail. The thing I wanna do, I wanna line this up and just get a rough mark where this little notch is gonna have to go. And keep in mind, this is not a flat in the true sense of the word. In fact, we're gonna go almost to the end. So now I know this is the leading edge, the high point, and the fillet. So I can kind of just interpolate a little bit in there, and I'll get the piece of scrap that matches this so I can sketch that in. Now I know right at the hinge line it's gonna be 5/16, so I can measure that off. I have the hinge line marked on both pieces, and this is really just to do it by eye. Undercut it first, take a small piece out first, and then just look for a high spot.
Just a little idea, and I'm going to take it on the underside first. Take a little bit less than I need out, drop it down, pick up the high spot, drop it down, pick up the high spot. I'd like to get as tight a joint there as possible, not have to fill it in with scrap if possible.
There's one way you could do it. If you want to be cute, you can take that piece and trace it on the other side. Since I'm just roughing this out, it doesn't really matter. And it's always the best of ideas is just take less than what you think you need and do the last little bit by sanding it in, just dropping it down, taking that with the sandpaper. Always better to be on the low side than on the high side. Having said that, it's probably going to be too much. Well, you can see by the gap how much we still have to go. So what I like to do now is put a little piece of tape up in the front that just holds that in position. And I can just start dropping that down, dropping it down. Now I can usually take a pen, if I can find a fine line pen that isn't that ink, and just lay it flat on the tail and sketch that out, or just keep sanding and biting away at it until that whole surface just drops right down and there's no filler piece needed, or as small a filler piece as I possibly can get away with. The trick here is to just pick up the high spot, pick up the spot where it's hitting, and I can very easily do that.
there's going to be a spot. I keep using a reference of sheetrock work. There'll be a spot where it hits hard. And from that spot, each time you do this, it'll lay down a little further. Now, I don't have the marker that I wanted. It was a real fine line marker. I don't have it. Let's get the tape joint back up there. And all I can do is just lay a pen on here. Looks like I'm going to have to take out. And you need to do this in little slivers. You can't just do this all at once. Take a sliver on this side out. Take the same thing on the other side. And this is the part where it's very patient. When everybody wants to go and take one sliver at a time. You want to take it out in one piece. If you just go on that pen line, usually you need 8 or 10 times to get it. As it falls down, that pen line changes. See, in the beginning, it's only in the front. Then as you're dropping it down, it's going to start picking up more and more in the back. Because you're dropping this down onto a hard spot. But this is the only way I know of that you can really get that fit. It really is accurately, especially on an airfoil tail or a semi-airfoil tail like this is. Now see, look at it from this angle. Get the tape up front. And you can see what's happening. Each time we lay this line out, we're taking more out of the front than we are out. Let's see, we got to go about a 16th of an inch. So this line eventually will run right to the back of the plane. Each time you repeat this operation, it'll get tighter and tighter. Now you can see the hard spot is in the back. So we need to get that pen. Make a little notation. All we want to do is find the hard spot. Now we're down to having just a razor shaving here. Important thing when it's all done is to get both of these angles so they'll sit flat on the tail. And I'll even take a little bit of extra wood off so I can fill that with glue and dust and get that real nice fit. Because what I want to make sure of is when I lay this on the tail, I don't want the rudder cocked off to one side or the other. I want both sides as they're coming down just to hit at the same exact time. The last little thing is to get a real nice square joint from our sanding table. Again, this is where the sticky back paper really comes in handy. Get as nice a fit as possible, of course. And don't think this is funny, but when they pull a real 747 together, a lot of times the parts are just, and then they have to trim them, and I'm sure that's the case. Now we want to just get this joint as tight as we can. A little bit of material down here where the rudder comes through, I want it to get out. I want to get a little bit of this out anyway. So we'll just take a piece of sandpaper, sticky back paper on a piece of scrap plywood like this. Get down in there and hollow that out as much as possible. See how much we have any hard spots here. That looks like it's going to be okay. On the other side, reasonable anyway. Make sure it's 90 degrees. Just to do a little test fit, I want to tape it in place. Pick up any hard spots, any spots that don't really match up the way I want. Now when I'm satisfied that I have it, I'll just tack it right about it in between each one of the tape spots. Make sure I don't have a bow or a... These shells are so delicate, you really have to work them very delicately. Tacking them in place first is a good idea. Now, the reason I like to put these tack joints in case I see something that's crooked, before I put a permanent joint on there, I can just razor it off. But now I can basically look from every angle, see that everything is straight, run my hand along here, see that I don't have any bows, because remember, this is really thin stuff. Now I got a triangle out. I want to check that I have 90 degrees here before I trim anything off in the back. I fill in this little gap just with a little piece of scrap. And each step I'm doing this, I'm picking it up. Make sure I'm not putting a twist in this. So it's so easy. Before I put a permanent glue joint on there, I want to check all of these angles that I'm at 90 degrees. The final glue fit really did work out well. Now it's just a question of the glue seam is run. I want to let that kick off. I want to get all these joints rough sanded in. This is what happens if you get a new computer. Your wife comes down and she starts shopping. I smell a credit card melting here.
Not a chance. Not a chance.
She's having fun with the new computer. Now, is this the family that works together?
I'm learning.
We have Spitfires on the table and wives over here learning about Dalyachkas.
I can't get back on.
Uh-oh, there goes the computer.
Before I do a final sanding on this, this is one of the things, one of those great little tricks you never think of. I want to get this glue seam. I have it glued on the outside, but I want to get it from the inside. I still don't have it totally sealed off, so I can kind of look down here if I get the light. And I can just get a bead going right down that joint. Oops. Well, you can watch it go right down, too.
We are going to have 6 million men in line. Hi, Sir Philip, you don't think they will cross the Rhine?
When you see it come out the tail post, you know you got it.
The first to fight on all the fighting seas. And if you think the Yanks won't swirl
it, this is... Right. One of the things that a lot of people have is a plane of a year later, you can see all the glue seams coming through because they don't double glue both sides. This is really worth its weight in gold here. And I'm just making that bead just walk right down the seam. Okay. And boy, that is definitely worth its weight in gold. That seam, and I want to get this pad out over the end of the table. Once that seam, I know, is dry. Got to do the other side first. The easy side. See, the easy side is the sides facing you. I get my little rhythm going here. And you'll see spots where if you got glue from the inside, it'll come out on this side. And what I like to do is after I sand this out and I feel like I've got that seam sanded, I'll go back and re-glue it and re-sand it the second time, because a lot of times the glue won't go all the way through and you sand through it as just a hair of glue holding that on. If you do the second shot, you got a better chance of getting a penetration right through. You get those really nice glue seams and they don't come through after you spend all that time buffing and put invasion stripes on and who knows what. Or your multicolored Brodak finish. Candy apple colors coming. Now see, that seam is sanded now. Even though it's sanded, I want to go back over it.
That's the grave of wedding and everything.
It's just cheap insurance to do this that we're getting at. Seam that's not going to come through in the final finish. Well worth the extra little time and effort you put into it. Well worth it. And because this fuselage really has a completely contoured egg shape, I don't want to cheat it and have, I'm trying to put a little bit of that curve into the fuselage side. After at least two gluings. Oh, that's perfect. That's nice.
Well, that's all we're going to have time for now. I made myself a little note so I don't forget that I have to tomorrow finalize that fit, get this whole back sanded out, and test fit that rubber. That's the next most important thing. I need to get all the clearances, put the hinges in, make sure everything is test fit. Everything is exactly in clearance. If it isn't, I need to make the changes, and I'll do that tomorrow. Now it's time for some supper.
Hey, one of the things I wanted to really do, there's a little tool I made a while back, a little piece of spare motor mount. And what I've been doing, I've been working this little area in here. This is one of those areas that, here's the advantage of the tool. You can get right in there and be like a dentist. And I want to thin this out and put a cap on the end, similar to the Seafire. Now the Spitfire and the Seafire are just a little bit different, and I like the Seafire way of doing it just a little bit better, so I'm going to replicate that. But having this little sanding tool really makes the blend between the rudder and this back piece a nice smooth fit. And the more I can take off, obviously, you know, the plane is getting lighter and lighter by a millionth of a gram a swipe here. Just like I'm getting lighter by the swipe every time I avoid eating pizza. A very handy tool to have, by the way.
Yeah, the original Spitfire rudder had a square edge here. And what I didn't like about it is it just has a kind of a funny hinge line. The Seafire had a little bit of a reverse curve, so the hinges kind of sit in. And that's what I'm going to try to do, is get the rubber sanding block and sand a little reverse curve in that hinge line so it looks just a little more scale-like.
Have that nice little rubber sanding block, some sticky back paper.
And what I want to do, I want to try to get that hinge just a perfect reverse curve in there.
Now, once you get a little bit of an edge started in here, I try to hold my fingers off to each side of it. This takes a little bit of practice. Hey, everything takes a little bit of practice. And now by getting this is my adjustment to get a real accurate fit on the rudder. And this will kind of make a little more realistic hinge line in the process. Now, you really couldn't do this on elevators where the surface is going to move 45 degrees. It just wouldn't work out. The mechanics aren't right. But on the rudder, we're really only going to move the rudder 8, 10 degrees.
What were you
doing? I'm just going to transfer the hinge pockets so I can cut the hinge slots. I'll do that with a brand new XL blade. I can't really get these half A hinges. The hinge slot is so thin it's very difficult to do with a party. Impossible to do with a party wheel. I want to get a full fit on this, and then I want to go around the whole perimeter of the rudder to make sure I get it a perfect match. Once those hinges are set, then I can make sure I have this contour and the contour on the bottom right, a perfect match.
You'll never be alone.
this is, I just want to mark them so that I know which side, I've done this already, where there's a hinge, I've cut all the spaces where there isn't a hinge. So I've made a little extra mark there.
What I have to do is I have to make sure I dig in there and dig out enough wood, because what happens if you don't dig out enough of these little chips of wood? Here's what happens is when you go to put the hinge in after the plane is all buffed out, this puffs up, and then you have a real, well, unattractive, ugly is a better word. And to get the, what I like to do is put the hinges actually in place and then do the sanding. This way, if any of them are going to puff up, just pull this extra wood out. If it's a little bit of a sloppy fit, it doesn't really matter. You can fill it with epoxy. Put a little cabosil in the epoxy and just fill it up. But if it's tight and this puffs up, you are dead. It really looks terrible. And I've seen that. I've seen many really nice planes. You look at where the hinges go in the flaps. You get these little...
is the hinges are actually in place, and I want to pick up any high spots in the wood. Otherwise, if these, by being pressed in, and they're a relatively tight fit, if they put a little pucker in the wood, this way I have two choices. I can get it out this way, or I can open up the little pocket for the hinge. It's cheap insurance that in that final fit, and it's that final fit when everything's buffed out, that it's really difficult to get back in there after these are epoxied in and get the wood out. It's real easy to do it now, very difficult to do it later. This is one of those jobs, pay me now or pay me later, and pay me now looks like a good idea. Now, if you'll notice, the bottom isn't an exact fit. So I'm gonna get a sanding block and trim it off about, be a 64th of an inch, but these are the little things, the little detail up here. This should be a perfect fit, and this down here should be a perfect fit. All the hinge pockets are nice and smooth now. Now this is all I'm going to be able to do in this session. Actually, what we're doing, we're going to a meeting this afternoon to ask
for the county for some permission to
maybe having future new flying field in Bergen County, but we don't have any high hopes, but we're playing with the house's money, and that's our project this afternoon when I get back to the house. I have to put this curve back in here. Okay, today what I did, I finalized that fit on the bottom, and you can see how I sanded that in. Put a couple of coats of thin CA, that's going to have to get brought back up to silver. Want to make sure I have all my fits right. Everything is nice and smooth. Now, one of the things you're going to run into from time to time, and whenever you're using these shells and you get them really, really thin, you can kind of squeeze them. It gets a little scary. But until you get this covered with either tissue or glass cloth, what I've done here, this is where it's really thin. I reinforced the inside, dripped in some thin CA, and just painted on a coat and wiped it off with a paper towel on the outside until I'm ready to cover this, which might be today or tomorrow, I don't know. I want to spend a little more time sanding. I want to harden up the edge. You can see how nice this hinge line came out with the little hidden hinges. There's a little bit of work left to do on the nose. And what I want to do, I want to glass the nose before I put the fillets on so that the glass actually goes right down there and then the fillet kind of bonds it together. This up here will need a little more work. I'm just feeling around. Always feel with your hand for anything that you think is going to be marginal. In this case, most of it feels pretty good. We're going to be doing some valve covers up here, some exhaust. This will all get buried, but I don't want to bury it and then put the cloth over the outside. I want the cloth right on this to act as a reinforcement. I think we did a real good job of engineering up a legitimate good pipe tunnel, good nose section. A lot of good things on this, and while we're waiting, and normally if I had the canopy, I would put the canopy on right now, but because I don't, I'm going to do the covering of the fuselage next. I'm going to do the last thing is a final sand out with 400 paper. Get every edge, every contour exactly the way I want it before I glass up the nose and then get ready I don't know if we have any enough time on this tape, but one of the next steps is going to be to glass up the nose.
One of the areas, I like to take 320 paper. I am going to go over this whole fuselage. In fact, I'll probably spend the next couple hours doing this. A good piece of tuned pipe tubing makes a great little tool for getting this fillet smoothed in. And this is one of the areas where a lot of people skimp. And what happens when you skimp on getting this all smooth sanded, you wind up later on filling it with either filler, talcum powder, something that weighs. So to get the lightest possible weight, what I want to do is get the wood parts absolutely perfect right now, or as perfect as I can make them. And I've got a variety of tools, starting with this piece of tubing, but getting in all the little crevices, all the little areas. One of the things I hope people have picked up real quickly off of the video, a lot of people have this idea that you do all your sanding with the palm of your hand, and they never can figure out why everything looks like a washboard. I try to almost never sand without having a sanding tool of some shape, and there's a whole box. I ought to lay them out at some point in time. But just having that box of all different shapes, and always not using your eye, using your hand to find the imperfections. This will allow you to really upgrade your skills in a hurry, no matter what level you're at. And this fit in here is one of those really, you almost never see anybody get it done where it's perfect and it doesn't have a bubble in the filler. Anyway, I've toyed with the idea, and I don't know if I'm going to do this because I have to make a decision, obviously, in the next couple hours, of carrying that glass cloth back onto the turtleneck, because I have this shell so thin now, I might even think about just using that half-ounce cloth on the whole fuselage. It works so well on that profile cardinal, and that fuselage is, if that one didn't break, I'm sure this one will never break. I mean, any profile, that one was really paper thin at the back. Anyway, another thing is all of these edges going up around here, all of these edges I want to re-harden up with thin CA, but always using my hand as the indicator of if I need a little more sanding there or not before I lay out any glass cloth. And we are really at near the end of this. I don't want to start and be in the middle of it and have to change tapes. I'd rather start that fresh on the next tape, but get all of the sanding done here, get all of the edges hardened up. Any thin spot in the shell, and you can really run your hand right down this whole side. In fact, talking about having a special tool, oh boy, where is my tool? I had a nice long block for dressing this off and getting in between under the horns. And anything you can do to smooth this surface out before glassing, or tissuing, or doping. Even 1 hour spent right now buys you a lot of hours somewhere in the future. Sanding tools. Now this is one that I always have. And see, it has square corners? But this one has relieved corners. Now see how much better this is for getting in corners, edges, angles, getting down in those corners, getting down in those corners. A sanding block like this, just replicate this with a quarter inch light play. This is a Bob Martens block. The sticky back paper, dress off the edges, and you've got yourself a real nice tool. Now when I want to transition into lighter and lighter sandpaper, I have sticky back 320, sticky back 400. You can buy it in all different grits, and this is really the way to get the final fit on the fuselage. Things I wanted to mention too, this is an appropriate spot. I got a real nice paint stand from Byron Barker. He sells them. It's really, really a nice piece of equipment. The only problem is you can see the confined area. We're bumping, you know, every time I set it up here a couple of times and try to figure a way I could use it. In the confined space, it's not really practical. But I do have the table with plenty of that bed padding on it. In fact, what I want to do before I do any further is slide that bed pad out over the edge. I like to do a lot of the sanding this way, especially on the fuselage. I like to lay it down so that the nose is resting on a pad and so that part of the pad is on the leading edge. And I can work that. And believe me, this is a very significant thing. A lot of people can't figure out how to get these areas. There's a lot of areas around the wing that
I'm going to spend a couple hours doing this. This is not a short-term thing. I'm not going to sit around having a cup of coffee doing this. I'm going to really knock myself silly because I really want to have the smoothest possible surface before I put any finish on here. And that's one of the things. Now think of what I'm doing. I'm removing material, so this is making it lighter to begin with. Also, it's crevices that I'm not going to have to fill with filler, so I win on both ends of that. And the plane right now is right about at the target weight I'd like to have at this point, that normally this size plane would wind up in silver. When the fuselage is silver, it would wind up about 30 ounces. And we're right on target to be at 30 or 31. Again, we have... There's so many other little details to put on this. Usually a semi-scale plane carries around 2 to 3 ounces of little details, hardware, pizza boxes in the canopy, bombs, scoops, whatever. So we really don't want to get too far ahead on the weight. I try like heck to keep it right to the very end, and then if I am still low, I can put on an extra couple of coats of clear dope or something. But right now, this is the spot at which, and this is a good way to do it, just the way I'm doing it. If you're working in a confined spot, but the thing is not to compromise, not to start thinking, oh, I'll be done in 10 minutes, I'll be done in 5 minutes, or have to be done, or just take your time. Get right up in these fillet areas, because when I do the fillets, I want to have that edge as straight and as accurate as possible. I don't want to be covering up chewing gum and all kind of mouse traps and things that are in there. I'm paying an especial lot of time and energy to get the fillet joints to where, right up to where the fillet is, at this point 90 degrees. Now because I don't have the flaps on, I can get right up in that corner. I can take my piece of extra sandpaper and just move it up right over those joints. So important. And it doesn't matter what plane, if you're building a profile, it doesn't matter. This part of it, this is where you need to spend that extra little time that seems like, oh gee, I wish I just get that done today, just get that done this afternoon. Then the plane is done, and you've got an extra 2 ounces of filler coat to sand off. Well, we're hoping we'll have the minimum when we get to that point. We'll be in good shape. Again, both of the other Spitfires came out weighing between 63 and 64 ounces. We like this one to be even an ounce lighter than that if possible, but we're certainly not shooting for 44 ounces here. What I really would like to have is all the joints cleaned up so that when I do that glassing, it'll really need no extra work in terms of sand, or very little extra work.
This is where it's really nice to have that offset tool to get right down in that area. This takes time. That's the hardest thing to convince me of, even, is just spend that little bit of extra time and get it perfectly smooth at this point. It really saves work later on. I think this is going to be easier. One of the things I wanted to do is not have the fillets in place while I'm doing all this work. I want to get that. There's a joint right there I want to make sure I can't feel it with my bare hand. Now on the next tape, we're at the end of this tape. On the next tape, we're going to be able to do the glassing, the final finish on this, possibly even the canopy work, but mostly I want to work off of these surfaces that have really a final sanding on them. So significant to me to not to have to go back after this is done, to have to go back and take out big chunks or fill things. At this point in time, we have no filler on the plane. This is the only filler I've had to do, one little spot up here, right? They had a little divot. That's the only... And you see, some people at this point in time, half of the plane is spackle. It looks like a sheetrock job. So I think that's a saving in strength and weight both at the same time by doing it that way. But anyway, we're going to pick this up on the next tape. We're going to do the glassing for sure. And at that point in time, I'll spend whatever time I have left today, get this really, really extra final sanded.
Well, we'll be looking forward to next week, hopefully getting the canopy mold back from Midgley, the molded canopies. We'll start laying out our canopy detail. But again, I'm already thinking of what's the time frame going to be. Supposing I don't get this back for another week. I mean, Dave's doing this on a volunteer basis. Well, I can start making up my mold for the exhaust, Siamese or individual. Or I can make both and then see which one I like. I can carve this little scoop down the bottom. There's always a point in time at which, and right now is a good time. I'm kind of in a waiting mode, and it's too late today to start fiberglassing. So what I want to do is start making a plan of what I want to do next. And if I get gaps in time, that I always have little projects to fill them in. Because a lot of people, they just wait until the last minute, the land, and they put a coat of dope on Saturday morning, and the rest of the day you sit and look at the airplane. Steve DeJulia asked me to make a special request for Dan Banjock. He is now, well, he's waiting for his canopies too. And word is Bob Whiteley's building a nice Mustang. I'm going to try to get him out of canopy. One of the things that Dan is looking for, there's a Mustang, and I'm looking through these Mustang books here and trying to find it, but it's a Mustang that has a checkerboard reverse angle. I don't know the name, but it's got a shark mouth, kind of a funky mouth painted. The rudder, it's the wildest paint job going. I think it's a good choice for Dan. It kind of represents, you know, his personality is kind of fun to be with guy. But anybody has any documentation on that? And of course, you can always try that Scale Research, Bob Banca Scale Research. They always have almost every paint job in the world available. Again, when you think Mustang, there's just no end to Mustang. Mustangs and Spitfires are probably the two big ones that there's just no end to the amount of paint jobs. And we're already thinking about it. And that those couple of pictures I got of the G-Fire, that really spurned me to thinking that might be a future model, the G-Fire. A red Spitfire. The point is, once you have the documentation, once you invest a little bit in books, then you get to this point where the end of the day comes and you can dream. And my good friend George Venturini has always reminded me, dreaming doesn't cost anything. You can sit and dream, check out the books, come up with some inspiration, come up with some ideas. I think it's just great that the hobby is going in a direction where a lot of people seem to want to participate in making semi-scale models. I think that's just unbelievably good. And it adds such a nice dimension to the hobby. Whiteley, if he's really making a Mustang and he uses one of Dan's canopies, I mean, I think that's just great that it can add a dimension to his modeling. And once Dan had that plug carved, and once we combine our efforts, and Dave has the molding machine, the vacuum forming machine, the whole event wins. It's so easy to figure out, it's unbelievable. And all that time I put in on that bulletproof glass, Leroy Black's going to build another Spitfire and put another one of those real sharp canopies on. So you know, you feel okay about doing all this extra work if you know more than one person's going to benefit. Look at the Siamese exhaust on that one. That one's got the exhaust covers. That's a very rare variation to have they had the flame retarder covers over that, so the pilot wouldn't have to look at the flames coming out of the exhaust. This is one thing we've given a lot of serious thought to, doing the really, really old roundel styles. These are the real early Spitz that had these early markings. I just want to thank everybody that's contributed over the years, and we're going on 4 years of building Spitfires and sharing the information, and it's really been a fun trip. And there's also a very realistic possibility that Karen and I are going to be going to England in the next 2 months. We don't know for sure yet if she's going to be able to get the time off work, but one of the things that allow me to do is shoot video actually in the Battle of Britain Museum. And Elliot has invited me to come to England, do a stunt seminar, and believe me, I will come back with video and pictures
at Battle of Britain Museum, but what a thrill that'll be to actually be there with the Spitfires. So many semi-scale models worth modeling, they're fun to model, always make for interesting models. And I just think maybe 5 years ago there was almost no semi-scale models, and right now I'm guessing one-third of the entries at these big meets are semi-scale models. Just great having all these possibilities for paint jobs, and every one of them is semi-scale. Dan, I really hope you're going to get some documentation very soon. Hope somebody out there will contribute some. Send it right down to Dan. Well, and thanks for joining us, and we'll see you on the next tape. We're going to finish this puppy up in a couple of weeks. Boy, speaking of a good choice for a semi-scale model. Wouldn't be surprised if Joe and I combine efforts at some point in time on one of these. Oh, that's another one of my favorites, the old P40, the Warhawk. Boy, that is, and I haven't given up on the idea of putting the shark's tooth on the front of the old Spit, too. That's a totally legit thing. Boy, I think of Frank McMillan's Martin Baker, Keith Trossel's Martin Baker scale ship. Boy, there's a world of cool stuff out there if you like to put in the extra effort to do semi-scale. Look at this, I'm so excited I can't even hold the page open. Unlike any prototype, it had the prototype, all the British prototypes had the P painted on them. And typically they would have the bottom painted yellow for visibility purposes. Boy, that's a beautiful model. Well, my hat's off to all the guys that do semi-scale. Billy Woolridge, Al Rabe, Paul Walker. Every one of them that's put in the time, and soon to join that list, Banjack. I'm telling you, there's just so many things worth doing in this hobby. And hey, please share the tapes with everybody, and please contribute your ideas. And in doing so, we'll just have a heck of a hobby, a better hobby than you could ever imagine. See you on the next tape.